So first, thanks Domenico and Sam for organizing this next year's seminar, for inviting me. Let me also take the chance to apologize in case there are any past speaker if I missed part of the previous seminars due to some unfortunate coincidence with my group meeting here, but I watched all of them, the recording, so I really enjoyed the series so far. Okay, so today I want to tell you about some small work I've done recently and about OPE coefficients of large charge operators. So the outline of my talk will be this one. I'll start with some motivation and why I thought this was an interesting problem. Then I'll review the well-known calculation of the scaling dimension of large charge operators, and I'll try to disguise it in a slightly different fashion, which will hopefully make obvious the generalization to the three-point function case. I'll then discuss the calculation of the OPE coefficients, indeed, and eventually analyze the result and conclude with some open questions. So let me get started. So we are interested in understanding quantum field theory, and this generically means mostly conformal field theories when you talk about UV complete theories. And this is quite an enormous task because there are infinitely many conformal field theories, and each of them is characterized by an infinite large set of CFT data. However, it came as a surprise, or anyway, it was a realization in the last 20 years, that there are some sectors of conformal field theories that enjoy some universality. Mainly their properties are up to a large extent described by the same physics. So these are the sector of large spin, which was analyzed by the bootstrap, well, first in this very nice paper, I think, well, first long ago, but the realization of universality in large spin, I think it's originally due to this very nice paper by Aldai and Baldassena, and then formalized within the bootstrap by Margotsky, Gboyadov, Fitzpatrick, Kaplan, Poland, Simons, Duffin, and Karo Nuot. Most recently, then the sector of large internal charge under internal symmetry, which was first analyzed by Hellman, Orlando, Raffert, Watanabe, and then with many works past that. And most recently, also the sector of heavy operators, so operators with large scaling dimension, has been shown to enjoy some universal properties related to thermodynamics, as emphasized by the paper by Lashkari, Dimarski, and Liu, and in 2D related to some higher genus partition functions, and recently also in relation to hydrodynamics in the nice work by Luca Delectas. So why such a huge amount of universality? And well, the key idea is to relate is that operators, which are the basic whose correlation function are the basic observables of CFTs, are related through the state operator map to states for the theory quantized on the cylinder. And such states, generic at the large internal quantum numbers, can be associated to somewhat universal phases on the general grounds. In the case of large spin, well, the picture is clear in ADS. Spinning operators are associated to objects which are spinning in ADS at far distances. And since in the dual ADS of the CFT, of course, and since interactions die exponentially in anti-de-Sitter, or if you want, since they interact only via very off-shell modes, they are well described by free particles to first approximations. The sector of large internal charge is associated to some finite density phase for the theory, and at t equals zero, generically bearing tuning, there are not that many. Essentially, without tuning, I think we know superfluids or Fermi liquids, and there are, of course, other phases, but it's not clear if they are generic. And the most generic one, we believe, is the one of superfluid theory. The receptor of large scaling dimensions is associated instead to some finite temperature phase of the theory. And this is generically described, including expectation, by thermodynamics plus hydrodynamics, at least in for dimension bigger than two, where thermalization generically occurs. So this picture justifies at least on intuitive ground why such a huge amount of universality. And in the case of large charge and large scaling dimension, universality is highly related to the existence of a macroscopic limit. So what does this mean? So generically, you can consider correlation function of two heavy operators, which create two heavy states, so delta H much larger than one, and many insertion of light operators, also scaling dimension order one. And this defines some correlation function of the cylinder. And now you want to take the limit, the flat space limit of this object. So in particular, in the regime where both delta and Q and or Q are much larger than one, this limit is defined as follows. So you take the radius of the cylinder to infinity and you keep the energy density and the charge density fixed. In this limit, you should recover, if you rescale cross ratios appropriately, a flat space correlator, which is generically will be of the form with light operator insertion between two finite charge and finite energy density states. So this just means condensed matter states. So CM here stays for condensed matter. Condensed, it's hard to write, matter. So, and why is this important? Well, this is because condensed matter states must realize nonlinearly the space-time and the internal symmetries of the theory, particularly the conformal group and possibly the internal symmetry. Therefore, generically admits some low energy description in terms of Goldstone modes, justifying again why universality. As I already argued before, for large charge, in case of a, say, one symmetry, the simplest option is that the ground state is found in a superfluid phase, whose CFT consists of a single invariant shift scalar, single shift invariant scalar. Now, the fact that correlation function, the macroscopic limit, so in the at very close distances, once you zoom in, can be described by such effective field theory, implies that by locality, the same description applies for the full correlation function on the cylinder. And this description will work in inverse powers of some cutoff divided the IR scale, which is the cylinder radius. And the cutoff will generically be given by the energy density to the appropriate power or the charge density to the appropriate power in the regime where the two are related. So essentially, symmetry breaking and locality are underlying the simplification which occur at large charge and large energy density. This, however, raises a question because we motivated this simplification in the limit where there is some macroscopic, in which there is some flat space well-defined limit. But such flat space well-defined limit does not occur for all the observables at large charge and large energy density. In particular, in the case of large charge, it's not clear if this is well-defined for correlation function of the kind Q1 or Q2, Q1 plus Q2, where all the charges are of the same order. So essentially correlation function, which you put an heavy insertion between the two states. So the question essentially motivating my work is, can we go beyond this perspective and argue that there is a universal form for these three-point functions? And of course, the answer to this question will be yes. So let me also add a second motivation, which is more technical in nature, but might be of interest for some of you. And it has recently been, well, it has been observed long ago that in perturbative theory, especially bosonic perturbative theory, such as the Wilson-Fisher fixed point in 4-epsilon dimension, perturbation theory breaks down for multi-legged amplitude, essentially because once you have many legs, you can contract them in many ways, and you have factorial factors that increase every loop corrections. In particular, if you consider the scale dimension of an operator of charge n, such as phi n in the U1 Wilson-Fisher fixed point, its scaling dimension go like n to leading order, and then sublinear correction going like epsilon n square, and higher order correction epsilon square n cube. So you see that perturbation theory around the vacuum requires epsilon n to be small. So even in the limit of small epsilon, if you go in the limit of large charge, perturbation theory breaks down. However, it was realized essentially following some remarkable developments of the 90s in in the problem multiparticle production by Song, Rubokov, and others, that one can indeed compute correlation function of these operators in the double scaling limit, epsilon to zero, and to infinity with epsilon and fixed using a semi-classical approach. And while, I mean, the ideas were general, the way these ideas were implemented was the following. Was you consider the correlation, the expectation value of the evolution operator in between two arbitrary charge and states, and you compute this semi-classical, so you expand the part integral around the, into the classical value. In the large time limit, this will allow you to read off the scaling dimension of the lowest dimensional operator with fixed charge and delta n. However, this approach is very based on a cylinder picture and it doesn't even require you to choose a specific state. And while this brings indeed the final result, which now is, takes the form of a double scaling expansion, it is not clear technically how to generalize it to three-point function. And even though I won't talk too much about it today, I just want to argue, just want to stress now that the ideas I will discuss, they indeed allow to overcome the technical issues that one could have imagined in these calculations. Okay, so that's all for the motivation. So if there are no questions, I'll get started with the true stuff. So, okay, so let me review. Okay, so now I want to present the calculation, the scaling dimension, the charge and operator in a fashion which will not rely in automatically on the macroscopic limit, but in a way that will make manifest the role of semi-classic, which is indeed the hero of our story. So to compute the scaling dimension of the lowest dimensional operator with charge Q in a theory with a U1 symmetry, you can generically consider, so I'll always assume that I have only U1 symmetry today for simplicity. So you can consider the expectation value of the time evolution operator in between two charge Q state. This will admit some part integral representation where this Q hat equal Q is just saying that there will be some boundary contribution that fix the charge. So just tell you, you have to integrate over the sector of fixed charge. And this will allow you to read the scaling dimension and large time limit. In the regime where Q is large, one expects, based on the example of, say, a quantum mechanics, could be the hydrogen atom, could be the rigid rotor, or whatever you have in mind, that such part integral will be dominated by a classical trajectory. So it makes sense to ask what are the properties of this classical trajectory in the large time limit. And well, this classical trajectory, first of all, must describe a classical state with fixed charge density. And this charge density, we said it will be, will define a scale mu just by dimensional analysis on the sphere. Mu will be much larger than the natural scale of the CFT, which is just given by the geometric scale, the radius. And this and such hierarchy of scales is generically a signature of the existence of an effective field theory description. And such effective field theory description, as I said before, should realize nonlinearly the symmetry of the theory. So the conformal group and the U1 symmetry. The natural question is how? So, and okay. So how are the symmetry realized by the classical trajectory? Just perhaps a comment, the fact that there is a classical trajectory which breaks symmetry does not mean that the true theory breaks the symmetry. Generically, as in the case of instantons, there will be zero mode upon which integrating upon them, you will realize the full symmetry group. But the point is that there is still a sense in which the part integral is dominated by some symmetry breaking physics. So the symmetry generator you have to consider are translation, special conformal, rotations, dilations, and the internal symmetry generated by Q. Now, translations and special conformal are naturally broken. Because if you think of this as, if you think of the states as inserted at some initial point x and some point x out going to infinity, so for a moment thinking back in flat space, of course, flat space and cylinder are one the same thing in CFT by value invariance. translations will translate the initial operator insertion. So it's broken. Special conformal will translate the inverse of the point at infinity. So just the fact that you inserted two states means that you broke these two generators. Now, what about rotations? Rotations, well, they leave invariant insertions in the limit in which they are far away, which is the limit where they are considered. So where this is, where this is zero, stress it again, this is infinity. So if you further add the hypothesis, which is generically true or you expect it to be true, that the ground state has spin zero, translate rotations will be unbroken. Or in general, the ground state has more spin, not more. So what about the Q? Well, here there is no kinematic argument that helps us deciding their fate, but we can argue on generic grounds that D and Q will be broken, and we generically expect only a linear combination of them to be unbroken. So why is that? D is the Hamiltonian for our theory in the cylinder. And it's a fact that in nature, often stationary solutions are, well, stationary configurations are found more often than static configurations. So like you have orbits in the case of planets rather than planets staying at rest. So this is what this means. The term translation generator will be broken, but you will have some periodicity essentially because there will be a new time translation generator. In this case, the only option that is a linear combination of D and Q, which is unbroken. Of course, you can imagine a situation where this is not true and both D and Q are unbroken. And the most notable example would be a free Fermi on the sphere that creates a free Fermi sphere. But I won't talk about it. And this is the symmetry breaking pattern that defines a conformal superfluid. So we see that from this semi-classical perspective, we've argued exactly the same thing that we said before from the macroscopic limit, that our state should be in some sense a superfluid. And I want to emphasize that this viewpoint, this semi-classical viewpoint, was for the first time presented in this paper by Sasha Moni, Enrico Piscalava, Riccardo Rattazzi, and Fiona Sable. Okay.
Sorry, Gabriel, can I ask you a stupid question?
Yes.
But how do you deal with the fact that translations are broken as well? Meaning, like, why is this like conformal superfluid and not like super?
This is because you are on the sphere, so the role of translation is played by rotations.
Ah.
Okay.
I see. Sorry. Yeah, you're right.
It's like for the solid, right?
So, yeah. Absolutely. Yes.
Yeah, no, but that's a good point. So this might be counterintuitive that translations are broken, but this is because you have to deal now with asymmetries on the sphere and a superfluid on the sphere as, time translation is D and J and J are like the translation.
No, it's clear, yes. Thanks.
Thanks for the question. So, okay, in summary, we've argued that our semi-classical path integral should break the symmetry in this way. So conformal times U1 to SOD times this new time generator. This symmetry breaking pattern is a fad that can be realized in terms of a unique Goldstone mode, which is a shift invariant Goldstone mode, which is moving linear in the Euclidean time. And you generically expect all the other radial modes of the theory to be gapped at a scale of order mu, so the only mass scale, the largest mass scale you have in the theory. And this you can be checking an example, but of course, this is only a genericity argument, so it may not always be true. For instance, in the case of superconformal field theories, you do have a symmetry breaking pattern, but the chemical potential is actually very low because of some supersymmetry, essentially. And this makes so that there are other gapless modes in the theory. And this has been analyzed in a nice series of papers by Helena Maeda, Orlando Leffler, and Watanabe, essentially from 2017 until now. And Simeon nicely reviewed these developments in his postdoc. So bearing this case in mind, which I won't mention, but okay, we can discuss it in the discussion probably. And the effective field theory in three, specializing now to D equal three, will be very simply written in terms only of chi, and the leading order action is just D chi cube. And the power is dictated by dimensional analysis. And notice this action is actually analytic in pi in the factorizations of the Goldstone field. and some leading correlation that can be systematically constructed from varying U1 invariant. For instance, the leading one was like d mu dchi or dchi square and a piece of the curvature. And C will be the leading Wilson coefficient in this action my normalization. Okay, so we want now to use this action to compute the two-point function, the operator OQ. And OQ again is the lowest dimensional operator at fixed charge Q. Now, if I want to do this calculation, however, in flat space, because I said before that flat space and cylinder are one and the same thing in conformal theories. So I told you how to write down the action that you should use. I didn't tell you how to represent the operator's insertion in the path integral. So this is the question we should address now. But again, even if you work in flat space, it's the state operator correspondence that tells you how to proceed. So you can imagine getting an operator insertion at xi and evolve it in radial time. This will generate a state on a ball of some radius r. And by the state operator correspondence, this state is really one and the same thing with the operator. So this tells you, even though that's not the way you normally represent operators in your theory, that to specify an operator, it's one and the same thing to specify some states on some balls. And what this is, this mean technique is that you should add some boundary condition for your path integral on balls centered at the insertion points. How do you do this technically? So you take your action, you cut these two balls out of the path integral, and you add some boundary terms representing these states. And it turns out that the convenient boundary terms are given just by this object here. So what this object here is minus I the charge of the insertion divided the volume of the sphere, integral over the surface of the ball, times the Goldstone mode. And this is just a generalization of the to the I and phi, say, wave function in quantum mechanics for, say, the rigid rotor. And essentially, this object here ensures that the charge, that the operator insertion of the right charge. You might ask if you should have added something else to represent your operators. I will prove in a moment that you didn't have to. But if you're worried that this procedure is not systematic, I just want to stress that, in principle, you have your theory. And you could solve your functional Schrödinger equation if you're strong enough to understand the wave functional of the state on the ball. And then use that wave functional to represent your state. In practice, when we will work in the limit of small radius r to zero, this won't be needed. Notice that the limit small radius r to zero is not really needed in conformal field theory by the state operator correspondence, but it's somewhat analogous to the large time limit I took in the discussion before. So it somehow ensures that the path integral is dominated by semiclassical saddle point. And also this procedure in the small radius limit essentially works also away from conformal field theories. Now that you have your action modified with the boundary condition, you can just vary it and see what is the saddle point configuration. So the saddle point configuration must satisfy the equation of motion, which is just charge conservation, where the charge, the only difficulty is that now g mu is a nonlinear object, is d mu chi d chi. But this is essentially just a Gauss problem, and the boundary conditions very nicely just specify that close to the insertion, the current should have the form that you expect from Gauss law, essentially. So pictorially, you have a nonlinear Gauss law problem, and the solution should describe just the charge flux in between the two insertions. That's what these blue lines depict. Very nice. So the solution, in fact, is very easy, and it's going to become clear in a moment why the solution is very easy. It's just minus a mu and the logarithm of the ratio of the distances from the initial point and the final point. And mu is essentially related to the square root of the charge. So square root of Q divided some fact which depends on the Wilson coefficient. Why is the solution that simple? Well, if you take this solution, you take the limit and this initial point going to zero, the final point to infinity, just recover a superfluid solution in the radial coordinate for the theory on the cylinder. So this solution just describes uniform charge flux for the theory on the cylinder. And this is indeed the solution that around which we wanted to expand. So we just found out in a slightly more complicated language that indeed the saddle point coincides with the one around which the action is proposed. But I want to stress more formally that the form of the solution is actually fixed in the case if our specification of the operator of Q is correct, then the form of solution is fixed by conformal invariance, because the classical expectation value of the current should coincide with the normalized three-point function of the current on the theory. So this tells you that the solution could have not been anything different. Or if you are more pedantic, I think this tells you that our specification of the operator of Q indeed does specify a primary operator with charge Q, essentially because of this argument here. Okay, so now we can just compute the classical action. And well, now the classical action, you just evaluate it and it's very easy. And you find that it goes like some normalization square divided the distance to the power delta Q from which you extract the scaling dimension. And here you recover the well-known result that the Q goes like Q to the 3 alpha, as first argued by Ederman, Orlando, F. Watanabe, with correction suppressed by 1 powers of Q. What's perhaps new is that here you see you also find some wave function normalization, which, as you see, is actually very simple. It's just the power of small r, which is was our regulators for the balls, to the scaling dimension delta Q. Okay. So you do indeed describe a flat space correlation function. And notice this is consistent with the form expected from conformal invariance, again, consistently with the fact that Q specifies a primary operator. And I want to stress that this approach, which may seem a bit artificial because normally represents operators by some functional of the fundamental field in the path integral, indeed actually works also in weakly coupled models where you do know the full action. You just have to specify, for instance, if you want to specify the operator phi n in the Wilson-Fischer fixed point, you can do it in this way by specifying some boundary condition on some balls. The only difference with respect to here that you have to add proper boundary conditions also for the radial modes of the theory. You don't only have the Goldstone mode in that case. But if you do that, you can actually see that you recover the known result in the double scaling limit for the flat space correlator.
Gabriel?
Yes.
If the operator had a little bit of spin, would you be able to add another boundary term maybe and recover the underlying operators?
So the point is that I think every modification made to this wave functional in the generic modification, the limit r to zero, it will die. It's a bit like taking the large distance limit, whatever. Yeah. But there must be a way not to specify say phonon states, and so I think that's technically more challenging because it's not obvious. You probably should.
I see. So you would be able to get corrections that that compete with the Q to the 3/2, but not subleading, or it's harder to get the subleading.
I think it's harder to it's harder to find a wave functional that. So the point is that in the small r to zero limit, even if you've not found the right wave functional, once you take this regulator to zero, you will collapse to the ground state essentially. Mm-hmm. And unless you tuned precisely your wave functional to specify an excited states.
But somehow force the spin to be non-zero.
Yes, and I don't know how to do it. I'm saying that it just seems a bit harder, but it should be doable. Again, in principle, you have your functional Schrodinger equation, and if you play with it, you should be able to construct all the states, I think. But yeah, that's a good question. Okay, sorry for this boring long introduction, but I think this will make now totally obvious that the same approach should work for three-point functions. So let me argue why. Now, we want to compute the three-point function of free charge operators, which are the minimal energy ones. And this is done essentially as before. We have three insertions. You just specify three balls around them with small radius, and you add the appropriate boundary terms in the action. So since we found before that this procedure does specify the primary operator we want, now in this case, this procedure will specify the three-point function we want. Now, why is this calculation, why this calculation can be done within the FT? That's perhaps the question you might ask. Well, physically, each of these balls specify a superfluid in the appropriate time coordinate, of course, so which will be the radial coordinate around each of these points. This means that excitations of the radial modes, so not the radial modes itself, but the excitations of the wave excitation of the radial modes, will be locally gapped by assumption around each of the insertion points. But I mean, if I don't have to care about radial excitation here, here, and here, I can self-consistently look for a solution which interpolates in between these balls just within the FT. And if this solution is such that the derivative expansion does not break, meaning if this solution is such that it's not singular, because it's the only way in which the derivative expansion can break away from these points, then this solution will be a good one. So in other words, if I don't excite radial modes here, here, and here, and I can interpolate between these balls smoothly, then radial modes will never be excited and the calculation can be done within FT.
Gabriel, but in order to have that, don't you need in each of the insertion to have a lot of charge?
Because yes, sorry, I should have said I'm working in the regime where N1 is of order N2, and they are both very large, say generic much larger than 1.
Oh, okay, okay. But so what if the N2 were small? I mean, could you do that anyway, or would anything break?
No, okay. So the point is that you see, right, say N2 is this one. So the amount by which the radial modes are gapped around here is square root of N2.
Right.
So if N2 is not sufficiently large, or square root of N2 over C, where C is a Wilson coefficient, if square root of N2 over C is not large enough, then the effective field theory breaks almost by assumption around here.
Right.
So so in fact, no. So you can have, say, N1 much larger than N2, much larger than 1. This you can have. The point is that everywhere it should be gapped. And correction will always go like the powers of the minimal gap. So like 1 over N2 in this case, not 1 over N1. Correction to my result. Yes, but thank you. I forgot to specify that I'm working in the regime where all the charges are large. The regime where one of the charges is small is the one that is associated with the macroscopic limit that I described before. So we already knew how to do it. That's why I'm not discussing it. I will mention it in a moment. And also apologize because I changed notation from Q to N's just to match with my plots later. Okay, just don't get confused. Okay, so now the only question you have to ask is how to solve for this profile. And again, the idea is to use the symmetries of the theory, and the symmetry is conformal symmetry. And it's also important that the action to leading order is homogeneous. To use conformal symmetry, it's convenient to define close relation. Why is that? I argued before that the solution of the two-point function was closely related to the expectation value of the current, which is nothing but a three-point conformal correlator. So in this case, my classical solution will be closely related to a four-point correlator with an insertion of the classical current. So it's convenient to define close ratios. So which I define like this, x minus psi square, distance of the middle with the final point, initial final, and something like that. And similarly for V. And as you know, you can generically write cross ratios as e to the 2 tau, and well, in terms of tau and theta, so in terms of some radial time tau and some angle theta, which will soon make obvious their meaning once you interpret the theory in the cylinder. And the claim is that the solution will depend only on these two coordinates. A priori, it could have depended on three coordinates, but conformal invariant tells you that this will not happen. The solution generically depends on two charges, N1 and N2. The last charge, of course, by U1 conservation is fixed to be minus the sum of the two. But due to the homogeneity of the action, if you rescale the field by mu, where mu I conventionally define to be the chemical potential at the first insertion, so N1, the new solution k tilde will only depend on the ratio of the two charges, which are parameterized through a square root, which I call y square root of N2 over N1. And in particular, I just a technical point, I put an I here such that k tilde now will be real. So you can check, once you look at your boundary conditions, that with this I in front, k tilde is real. And if you remember, that's because already in the two-point function case, chi was minus I mu tau. So if you rescale with minus I, this will also in that case, it will be real. Now the problem reduces to, again, charge conservation, which in tau and theta coordinates just coincides very intuitively with charge conservation on R times S2, where tau and theta are just the radial and angular coordinate, with boundary conditions such that chi tilde for infinite time in the past is linear in tau. So it specifies essentially physical superfluid with charge n1. So you mapped one of the two insertions at minus infinity. The last insertion is again linear, but with a different coefficient, square root 1 plus y squared, where y is just where how much the change in the slope depends on the ratio of n2 over n1. So you map the other insertion to a superfluid of charge n1 plus n2 at time plus infinity. And the new thing here is that the change in the slope is closely related to a new singularity at tau equals 0 and theta equals 0, which is the point where we mapped how there were center insertion, which will be logarithmic, log tau squared plus theta squared, and it will be as strong as y tells you. So the picture now is that you won't have an homogeneous charge flux for the tier and the cylinder. You will have some charge flux n1. Then you will have some singularity imputing some new charge in your Gauss law. And eventually they will become again uniform, very much in the past at tau at infinite time. Notice that I just want to stress the fact that I'm putting n2 to be the charge here in the middle is totally conventional. I could have chosen different coordinates where I would have had a superfluid with charge n2 at time past infinity, an insertion of charge n1, or vice versa. I mean, this is just in these coordinates, I parameterized one of the insertions to be the singular points, but in some coordinates, the singularity will just look like a superfluid and vice versa. This is essentially the picture. And I also should say that a focus for simplicity in the regime where n1 is bigger than n2, bigger or equal, which is bigger than zero.
Can I ask you another question? Yes. Why is it a log? Why is it obvious that it's a log around there?
Why is it a log? Well, I don't know whether it's obvious, but the idea is that you want j mu in the original coordinate close to the insertion to go like x minus the insertion point. So let me center it. Let's say that it's centered at zero, the insertion, x mu over x cubed times the charge by Gauss law. And this is like d chi, something like this. So if you, since you have some derivatives in the log, it's essentially what does the job for you. But again, this also depends on the coordinates that you chose, right? But that's why I log. And I was just saying that I will focus, I mean, I can always focus on the regime where the charge n1 is bigger than n2. By permutation symmetry, I can exchange them, so there is no loss of generality. And the regime where two charges are negative is just related by time reversal to this, so there is no loss of generality in doing this. And the point is that now this is a totally well-defined boundary problem, even to a singular one. And probably someone is strong enough to solve it analytically. I'm not, but you can always plug it on the computer, write a small code, and get the solution. And generically, the solution will look like this. So this is the solution for k tilde in the case y equal 1. Y equal 1 means just n1 equal n2. So you see the solution around here, it's linear, goes like tau. So at large negative time, you see that it approaches a linear one. Large positive time, it goes like square root of 2 tau. You can check that it is true. So you see the solution approaches the boundary condition exponentially, actually. And you have a singularity at the other insertion point, tau equals 0, theta equals 0, around here, which is a indeed a logarithmic singularity. And this logarithmic singularity is likely to deform the solution around it. So you see here it's not, it has some curve. I don't know how much you see it from this 3D plot. And in fact, I'm just plotting, you see, it approaches so fast the boundary condition value that I'm just plotting between tau 4 and minus 4, but actually my cutoff was much larger than that in the numerical solution. But it's actually an easy, relatively easy numerical problem. But at least I could do it, and I'm not good at these things. So, okay, now you can solve this for many values of y, compute your classical action, and which on shell nicely reduces to boundary terms. It's a very easy calculation. You just have to look at the boundary value of your solution and obtain the OPE coefficient. So, and the OPE coefficient generically will go like exponential of n1 to the 3/2 in my convention, some normalization factor, which I chose for convenience, and a function of y, which is again the square root of the ratio of the two charges. And this function of y, you obtain it numerically and it's plotted here. So in particular, I normalized it such that f of one is almost one, it's like 0.99. So the OPE coefficient grows exponentially fast in the charge, essentially, when they are all the same order. And I'm gonna comment about it in a moment. But since this is the main result of my work, before discussing it, probably I should ask if there are questions on how you obtain it. So
yeah, so one question. So the F you got from the numerics, but the N1 to the 3/2 divided by square root C, you can see analytically?
Yes. So yes, because if you remember, I rescaled by square root of N1 my solution. So since the action is homogeneous in chi, eventually that's why the N to the 3/2 comes from.
I see. Okay.
Yes, so the only numerical input is this F of Y. Okay, so this is the main result. Okay, it's what it is. Let me discuss why this result. So when I first got it, I found some exponential growth here, and you know we are not used to say that things should grow exponentially, and I was a bit worried. So let me convince you that this makes sense. So to do so, I will analyze first the result in the small y regime, which as Domenico mentioned before, can also be analyzed by other mean. So there is something to match. And also we analyze the y order one regime. So analyze the result. One thing I forgot to mention. Yes. So since this solution here is totally smooth, it's totally obvious that the effective field theory never breaks down. As I said, the self-consistent, the approach is self-consistent as long as you don't have any other singularities but those at the insertion points. So that's a point that this plot should make very clear, I think. So it's forgot to mention. Yeah. So let me analyze the result for N2 over N1 much smaller than one. And in fact, I mentioned before that this is the regime where you have a good macroscopic limit. And in this regime, OPE coefficient, but matrix element of light operators can be obtained by a operator matching. So what does this mean is that, as it was first emphasized in this business, but it's well known in the case of Payon Lagrangian, for instance, but it's been said in this paper of 2016, this means that you can represent your local light operators in terms of your low energy degrees of freedom, which in this case are just your Goldstone boson. So if you match quantum numbers to leading Gordian derivative, the only way you have to represent an operator with charge Q is to write the chi to the delta Q, e to the IQ chi. So you match the scaling dimension and the charge and some unknown coefficient CQ. If you do that for, in our case, you find that, and you just evaluate this between a large charge background, you just find that the OPE coefficient goes like this C N2 in this case, because I take N2 small, N1 over C to the delta N2 over 2. Delta N2 goes like N2 to S3R. And some correction that I exponentiated for you. So here this is, and this is some numbers like 0.05051, plus corrections, but whatever. The important thing is they go like n2 squared over square root of n1, and then n2 to the 5 half over n1. So they're organized in a series of n2 over n1. And this I will first obtain in my recent paper. And right, so now you might ask, is the result we found semi-classically compatible with this result here? Because this regime, which if you take now n2 to be large, so in the regime one, much smaller than n2, much smaller than n1, both the operator matching approach and the semi-classical approach should work. So the two results should agree. So how is this possible? These two results agree. I mean, this function here and one over C doesn't seem to be a function of the ratio. So, well, if you look back at the form before, which was like lambda e to the n1 real f of square root of n2 over n1, this is compatible if and only if this cn2 takes this form here. So it's like 1 over n2 up to the Wilson coefficient to the power delta n2 again, and up to a number which I call alpha, that it's a constant, it doesn't depend on n2. And similarly, f of y should also be constrained. Of course, we know it from numerics, but I'm assuming for a moment we don't know it, and should take this form as small y, square root of 4 pi y cube, and the leading term is just this minus log y, small y, and a subleading term which is related to this coefficient alpha related to match, and the next subleading term which is related to this correction here and higher order corrections. So the matching between these two results puts strong constraint on the form that this should have. And now if you can compare, now you can, in particular, you can ask, is actually this functional form compatible with our numerical result? And you find it is very, very well compatible. In particular, you can also determine this coefficient alpha here numerically for these operators. We come to order minus 0.3. And here I plot the comparison. So the black line is the numerics, the exact result. The blue line is only the leading order approximation that should come from the matching, where there is no known coefficient. And you see that it matches very well up to y 0.2, 0.3. And then it starts deviating quite a lot around y 0.5 and 0.6, and eventually totally fail. The red line is the improved approximation, where I have the subleading next to subleading order, where this minus 0.3 is obtained numerically. And you see that it's actually a very better match, but okay, it still fails in the large Y regime where you're not supposed to use it. But anyway, we are assured that the growth we found, at least a small y, makes sense because it matches the previous findings on the about OPE coefficients. Now let's look at the most interesting and most new regime, which is the one where the ratio of the charges is of order one. So as I said before, I normalize everything such that when y is of order one, the function is of order one. Therefore, the OPE coefficient goes like e to the n to the 3r, which is essentially e to the scaling dimension delta n1. And this scaling, I want to argue, as I already said to Luke, it's totally unavoidable because as a consequence of locality and dimension analysis, the action on precisely the Lagrangian evaluated, for instance, on the cylinder just a dimension analysis, must go like the largest dimensional scale in the theory, which is just rho. So, and if you measure dimensionalize rho to the CR, rho is the charge density. And that's why the scaling. This behavior, reassuringly, and I want to thank Sridi for discussion about this, is the same one which has been found for OPE coefficient of heavy, heavy, heavy in 2D conformal field theories by totally different methods, by Cardi, Maloney, Maxfield in 2017, and generalized further in this paper by with Collier et al. Most recently. And the reason why we shouldn't be worried about this growth is that the fact that the OPE coefficient grows exponentially is just a convention how we define the OPE coefficient. So we define this OPE coefficient to be essentially the O bar say to n infinity, O n one, O n zero. So we define the OPE coefficient with the operator disposed in this way. But if we were to dispose them in some other way, we would find a different result. I mean, it's not physical, but what we call OPE coefficient is just convention. In particular, if you take, say, in the regime where all the charges are, where n1 is equal to n2, the tripling function just reads 1 over x to the delta n times the OPE coefficient. So if you use this formula here, you find the result goes like this. So you see that at very far distances, actually, the three-point function indeed does decay exponentially as you like, and there is no big trouble in having an exponentially large OPE coefficient. Before, we were able to find some approximate expression for our results combining numerics and analytics at small y, so we want to do the same now at y order one. And here, it's convenient to use the fact that I mentioned before, that the result is independent of permutations of n1 and n2. So if you recall the form here, this implies that our function f of y should satisfy this property here, of y for y cube f 1 over y. First thing, this simple formula provides you a very non-trivial consistency check of the numerical result, because now you can solve your problem, say, for y between 1 and 2, and compare for your solution between 1 half and 1. And I found excellent agreement. So, okay, it's just a consistency check for the numerics, which is always good to have once you're solving something like a PD, a singular problem. Most interestingly, this result here, if you Taylor expand it, tells you something very simple, that the first derivative in general, the odd derivatives are related to the even derivatives of the function. So to leading order, just f prime one is just related to f1, just a simple algebraic observation. But if you combine this information with the Taylor expansion of the function around one, you actually can find this approximate expression, this linearization of the function. And what I want to stress is that the value f of one, you have to use your numerical value, but this relation here actually buys you, bypass the steps of fitting the slope here. And if you use that f of one is essentially one, to a good approximation, you find a very simple linearization. And I want to summarize the comparison here. So this green slope here is this linearization that I just discussed, and you see that in fact describes very nicely the result in that for y essentially bigger than 0.5. Here also for summarizing, also put the plot of the solution of the small y approximation of the OPE coefficient, which is this one. And the black is the numerical slope. So you see that in practice, we have obtained a result for the OPE coefficient up to a function f of y that was determined numerically, but to a very good approximation, we also know it analytically, combining again numerics and previous results and some consistency facts. So we have an almost, I want to say this, just all I want to say that this result is almost analytical, but okay, that's just what it is. And okay, so that's the last thing I wanted to tell you. And okay, so if there are no questions, I'll just conclude. And let me just summarize. So the main point of my talk is that semi-classical ideas and effective field theory tell you that the form of the three-point function, three-R charge operators, is actually universal, and it actually allows you to compute it in the regime where all the charges are large. These ideas, these very simple ideas, in fact, allow you to overcome the technical problems that exist in similar calculation weakly coupled models in the triple scaling limit. I'm not going to say it. And it's quite obvious that the same approach allows to compute higher point function. For instance, if you compute a four-point function with four charge operators, you might be able to access the OPE coefficient of the excitations just by matching for conformal block expansion. I should say, however, it's quite less obvious how to include quantum corrections in the game, because now you would have to expand your action around to do a fractation determinant around the nonlinear around this profile, and which whatever coordinates you write it is anyway not too nice and just numerical. So okay, that's a bit technically more challenging. At a more speculative level, one might ask if similar ideas can be used to compute the three-point function of any operators from hydrodynamics. And okay, I should say I was more optimistic about this point some time ago. but it's still not totally clear. I would still, still not totally clear to me if anything like this should hold in that case. But okay, something to explore further. And finally, at a super speculative level, one of the motivation for me for this problem at the beginning was try to learn, even only at a technical viewpoint, some lessons for the semi-classical problem, which describes the multi-particle production issue. So the processes say too many in bosonic theories that I also described the semi-classics, but the semi-classical problem I think has never been solved properly, even if it has been formulated in the old papers by Poloshin, Lubokov, and especially Son. There are some analogies with the problem we saw today. Also in that case, the semi-classical problem must be singular. In that case, in our case, the singularity would account for the charge flux needed for Gauss law to hold. In that case, the singularity would account for the change in energy that occurs in between the initial and the final state. But technically, that problem is still much more complicated, first because it's Lorentzian, so there is no clear way to formulate it purely in Euclidean time, which for me at least was technically very useful to have a boundary value problem that you can plug on the computer. And more conceptually, it's not clear whether there is any EFT picture in that semi-classical problem, which might simplify our life. So I said this is even more speculative than the case of Hydro, I think. And with this, before taking question, I'd like to thank you all for the attention and conclude.
Okay, thank you very much. And I just love you for coming on. Okay, are there questions? I already had asked you a couple of things in the talk. There were also other questions.
But I had one question. Maybe it's...
Go for it.
So in the case that you mentioned at the very end of applying similar ideas in Hydro, don't you need like some kind of information about black hole merger? It's a question about black hole merger, no? I mean, it's some kind of very strange exclusive process where two black holes merge exactly to a new black hole without any radiation or particles.
Yeah, I mean, so this is because, so physically, yeah, that's what would you expect. So,
I mean, it sounds like a very rare process. It should be extremely exponentially suppressed.
I think you're right. I mean, when I first saw this question, right. What happens is that this approach would allow you to compute what is the non-random part of the HHH OP coefficient somehow. But that non-random part is probably either zero or extremely small. So I would agree with you. In fact, this is because it's a boundary value problem. It's not an evolution problem, as you say. I'm fixing boundary conditions at all the points.
You're fixing it at infinity, that you have one
at infinity past and at the singularity.
Isn't that what you would call like an exclusive process in
particles? Yes, it's an exclusive process. So I think indeed is that problem is, I mean, I now think that there is no solution. I'm not entirely sure, but most likely there is no solution within non-dissipative Hydro, which probably means that what fixes the universality form, the universal form of HHH, if any, must be something else and not these semi-classics. But it's not yet totally clear to me.
Is it even mathematically possible for two black holes to merge without emitting radiation?
So from the gravity perspective, I wouldn't know, but you can ask the problem, can you solve the hydrodynamic equations with these very specific boundary conditions? What's like the first thing? And I'm confused whether you can or not. That's where stage where I'm lying up. I would now bet most likely not. We have some discussion, but it's not, I'll update you once I know for sure, but.
It's kind of some kind of question about the quadruple moment, right? You have to compute the square of the quadruple moment of the merger process. It would be somewhat surprising if there is a way to merge them without any radiation. But...
Yeah, I think you're right. No, but I now think you're right, but, I mean, I still am not 100% sure, so I still wanted to pose the question because people might have better ideas than me.
Other comments?
Well, maybe if I can ask just a clarification. So basically, as long as just to see that I understand. So in the three-point function, which everyone is heavy, right? Mm-hmm. You have this saddle, which has this logarithmic singularity at the insertion of the mid one, right? While it's then you match it to the case in which one of the insertion, the N2 insertion, becomes light, right?
Yes.
But you said already that in fact that problem would be solved just by adding a simple light insertion to the two-point function, right?
Yes.
But that singularity would be there also in that case, right? Or can you really just, in the case in which one is light, just to take the saddle of the two-point function, the one that you find there?
Well, the way you solve the problem is different. The way you solve the problem is different here. So here you just, I mean, by really that so the that's a good question. So say here you just perturb around the solution, around the unperturbed solution.
Yeah.
So if you want, you can do semiclassics, but on the fluctuations. And you have to linearize the equation. And if you want, linearization doesn't commute at the it's not good at the singular point generically. So yeah, I'm saying that technically you wouldn't have the same singularity. I mean, essentially, or if you want, you can just do quantum fluctuation here around the background minus I mu tau. I think that's the easiest thing to think about. Okay. Really, this result comes from perturbing from a non-singular solution. And this is not the same thing of finding a new singular solution in general. So even technically, this matching is only technically, I think this matching is not straightforward.
So basically let me say again, like in the limit in which you send exactly N2 very small, I should not really recover this simple background, right? This chi equal to minus mu t. I should have
In the limit N2 going to zero, of course you recover chi minus I mu t. But the point is that as soon as you have, as soon as you have N2 non-zero, the solution around here will never be a small perturbation of chi minus I mu t, just because it's singular.
Right. Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So essentially linearization that never works to determine the strength of the singularity.
Yeah.
This is where it's non-linear, the problem.
Yeah. Okay, I see.
But in any case, it sort of works because that is multiplied precisely by N2 over N1, right?
Yeah, it's sort of a singular limit, but in the, you can probably show that, yeah.
I mean, I'm just saying that the condition that you have around that singularity has an N2 over N1 in front. If N2 is zero, that seems to go away. Of course.
But I mean, I'm saying that you cannot solve this problem perturbatively with this boundary condition. That's what I'm saying. So every linearization you do would change. The boundary condition changes. So I don't think in this approach you can actually solve even a small N2 by linearizing it.
Yeah.
And which is what you would do instead in the case where you match here. Here instead, that's, I think, by definition, what you should do. Right. I mean, the solution, the linearized solution and the singular and the true solution, they kind of resemble each other far away from the insertion points. And in fact, this was very useful for the numerics, because to do numerics and linear probably you have to do some kind of mutons and you have to put some guess. And this helped me construct the initial guess somehow. But close to the insertion point, I had to amend that perturbative solution in a smarter way.
But is this related to what I was asking you before, that this works done like this only if the three operators are all heavy? Because as you said, things break around the other insertion.
I think that's the technical manifestation, what you're saying, that I'm assuming that I can describe the three insertion points, all of them very precisely, because all the radial excitations are gapped. Instead, what I physically assume here is that I don't I smear out the UV operator with my low energy degrees of freedom, and things are gapped just because they were gapped in the original background. And I'm describing, you know, some.